Hi, welcome back to my channel. On this channel, we talk about different things as relating to our Christian faith, and we challenge one another to live a victorious Christian life. My name is Kathy, and I'm so glad you could join me in this conversation, which I have labeled, Do You Know God? Our text is going to come from 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 1. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. And in those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not so many visions. This could be likened to, you know, today, that there was not so many visions. It could be that the children of Israel had hardened their hearts so much to the word of God. The hardness of the heart amongst the people of Israel was so intense, and the corruption in the priesthood caused God to withdraw the spirit of prophecy. What do you mean by the corruption in the priesthood? If you read in the chapters before, you find that Eli's children were very corrupt, and Eli did not correct his children. He did not cause and lead and guide his children in the way of the Lord. So this might be the reason why, you know, God withdrew the spirit of prophecy. God will speak and guide his people, you know, when his people seek him and when his ministers seek to serve him diligently. And I thank God because God is raising up a generation that will not be satisfied with human accomplishments and call it ministry. You know, where people will do all sorts of things and call it ministry, in the name of ministry, you know, selfish ambition. And this causes the Lord to actually harden his heart, and the vision is rare. Nowadays, you will hear prophecies that have nothing to do with God's kingdom in this day and age. And that's why we need to turn our hearts back unto God. Verse 2 says that one night Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was laying down in his usual place. You know, his eyes being weak is, it could be spiritually and it could also be physically true, which means that Eli had become such an effective leader. You know, vision, eyesight, you know, seeing. How do they say it? That seeing is a function of the physical eye, but vision is a function of the spiritual eye. So Eli had become, his eyesight had become dim. You know, he couldn't see and he couldn't hear God anymore. Verse 3 goes on to say that the lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was laying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of the Lord was. This is an indication of the dark times, you know, in Israel. The Bible in the book of Exodus, chapter 27 and verse 21, it says that in the tabernacle of the congregation without the veil, which is before the testimony, Aaron and his sons shall order it from evening. You know, Aaron and his sons are to keep the lamps burning before the Lord from evening to morning. And this was to be a lasting ordinance among the Israelites for the generations to come. This is an indication that in our lives, the light of the Lord, we have to keep our lights shining bright at every given moment. We don't need to let our lives be dimmed, you know, with whatever is happening around us. Leviticus chapter 6 and verse 13, it says, the fire must be kept burning on the altar continuously, and it must not go out. Isaiah chapter 60, it challenges us and it tells us to arise and shine, for our light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen up upon us. Verse 2 says that darkness will cover the earth and thick darkness over the people, but the Lord will rise up upon you and his glory will appear over you. Nations will come to your light and the King to the brightness of your dawn. It is so important that the light of the Holy Spirit keeps on shining within our lives, that the light of God, we don't, you know, the Bible tells us not to keep our light under the bushel, but let our light shine. We are like a city that is set upon a hill that should not be hidden, you know. And so this, when the light of the Lord was growing dim, it showed the spiritually dark times, just like the times that we are living in right now. Verse 4 says, "Then the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, 'Here am I.' And he ran to Eli and said, 'Here am I, you called me.'" We can see that Samuel had a very obedient heart towards God. You know, he said he ran to Eli and he heard the voice, which makes me think that probably, you know, the voice was audible because he could hear it. And he ran to Eli because he had not yet known God. And he said, "Here am I." God is calling out to us today. He's saying, "I am calling you today. I am calling you, my child. Will you hear and will you answer? Whom shall I send?" The Bible asks. And you know, God called again. And usually, you know, from the scriptures, we can see that this is the third time I am coming to you, the Bible says. And in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. God calling Samuel again was a confirmation. It's like God had called him one time and then he had to call him another time. Usually we get confirmations when God calls you and says, "Kathy, I'm calling you to do this." He usually will confirm it either in your spirit, in your witness, or he'll confirm it, you know, through another way, and you will know in your heart that God is calling me to do this particular thing. Verse 7 says that, "Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him." He was godly, Samuel was obedient, serving God, and yet he did not know God personally. We see it all the time in our congregations, people who are so diligent in serving God, but it's like their spiritual eyes are shut, their spiritual ears are shut, that they don't really know what it's all about. And that's why I find that in the body of Christ, people are so deceived. You know, they are so obedient. They want to serve God. They want to live for God. But yet they have found people who really do not know the word of God, and they deceive them. You know, this is the case that, as was with Samuel, he was serving God. He was daily in the temple. You know, he was living for God, but yet he did not know God personally. It is more than carrying your pastor's Bible. Serving God is more than, you know, sweeping in the church. I'm not, you know, despising the service that we do in the church, but more than all this eye service that we do, we need to make sure that we know God and know God for who He is. You know, and even children who are raised in godly homes, they have to be converted by the Spirit of God. We see Samuel, you know, serving God, raised in the temple, but yet did not know God. I say it all the time of pastors' children. You know, we think that, oh, you know, pastors' children have to be perfect. No, if they've not been converted by the Holy Spirit of God, you know, we cannot expect little pastors' children to be little pastors. You know, no, they need to know God for themselves. And unfortunately, in the world, we have a lot of inspired Christians, but very few changed ones, all because of the message, the error in the message from many of the pulpits that we know. Super fake religion where anybody can be anything they want to be, come the way they want, to come and stay the way they, you know, they stay the same way they want, and then they can serve God anyhow. This is not what God wants for us. God wants our lives to be transformed. He wants our lives to be changed. He wants our lives to be more and more like Jesus Christ. And this is what, you know, we have to do when we are preaching the word. We have to edify so that the people will become more and more like Jesus Christ, to be transformed into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 10 In the book of 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 10, it says that, and the Lord came, you know, and he called Samuel, Samuel. And Eli had told Samuel that, you know, when God calls you again, you know, you have to say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." It says, and the Lord said unto Samuel, I will do a new thing in Israel, at which both the ears of everyone that heareth shall tingle. We have to make ourselves available for God to speak. And we have to respond to the word of God. We don't have to be presumptuous about God speaking. And we have to humble ourselves before God. And we have to tell him, "Speak, Lord," that we are listening. And we must learn and we must train ourselves to hear from God. All the voices around us mean nothing, not unless God speaks through all these voices. So let us always look. Let us always look for the voice of God in whichever message that we hear. You know, the Berean Christian was a more noble Christian because after Paul had preached, they had to go back to the scripture and they had to go and search and find out what was Paul actually talking about. So as children of God, when we hear, you know, preachers preaching, we have to find out, is this from the word of God or is the preacher overtaken by emotions? You know, next time we are going to see in part two, after Samuel had responded to the call of God, when he had said, "Speak, Lord, for your servant listeneth," what message did God have for Samuel? You know, I'm excited to share this message with you, and I hope you'll join me next time as we look into the message Samuel had received from the Lord, as we challenge ourselves to live a victorious Christian life. This is Kathy challenging you to live a victorious Christian life. Keep the faith.